from Marlton, Arkansas. He's here with his wife, Lauren, and their children. I'm not sure they're here, but they have two children, Jack and Caleb. Lauren is also, this is kind of a homecoming, I guess, for her, as she grew up at the Knight Arnold congregation, and also her mom worked as a secretary for over here at Forest Hill for some time. Brother Matthew is a 2005 graduate of the Memphis School of Preaching, and also he served with the Forest Hill congregation for 3 years as her associate evangelist. So we got to see him somewhat on a daily basis around here for a while, and of course enjoyed that. But after that, he returned to his home state of Arkansas, where he currently preaches for the Guy Church of Christ in Guy, Arkansas. He's authored numerous tracts on various Bible topics. He writes the New Testament Christian, which is a biweekly publication, and it's mailed to over 3,000 people in central Arkansas area. And I'm glad to know that, because I've said before, you know, we don't catch any fish if we fish in the boat. So we have to get out, cast outside the boat to catch the fish. And so church, we need to get outside the church building with the gospel, don't we? And he's doing that. He's co-founder and organizer of the Central Arkansas Gospel Crusade, an annual area-wide gospel meeting held on the campus of the University of Central Arkansas in Conway, Arkansas. He's going to be speaking to us this morning on the topic that a New Testament Christian understands restoration, and we look forward to that.
I'm going to unbutton my jacket. And I might say ain't, but we'll see. I could spend the entire time that I have allotted for me just expressing my gratitude for this congregation and for the school that I was honored to be a student at for 2 years, and for the 3 years in addition to that as the associate. I don't know what kind of a man I would be were it not for the Memphis School of Preaching and for the Forest Hill Church of Christ. I made friends here that I will take into eternity. I see a lot of them here, and I'm thankful for that. I met my wife here. She wasn't my wife when I met her, but she became my wife soon after, very soon after, and I'm so happy that she is everything that keeps me going. So I'll just, instead of doing that for an hour, I'll just condense that to just saying thank you and leave it at that. The Bible student might think that because the so-called restoration movement began after the Bible was completed, that the Word of God only could speak of the topic in generalities. On the contrary, the Bible has numerous references with great specifics on the concept of New Testament restoration. It's a mistake, I think, to differentiate the ongoing process of God's people to take the gospel to the lost, people who originally were pure and in perfect harmony with God, but then by their sin were separated from God. And with separating that from the idea of a restoration movement of preaching the gospel to an entire country and also to a world of people who are separated from God. There ought to be no difference. We look at the one and we say, we're preaching the gospel to save souls, and rightly so. But in a sense, salvation is a form of restoration. They were with God, those lost souls. They sinned and lost that life and fellowship and harmony with God. In being saved by obeying the gospel, by believing Jesus, by repenting to Jesus, by confessing their faith in Jesus, by being baptized into Jesus, they are restored to a relationship that they lost by way of sin. When we preach the gospel to a child of God, or teach a child of God who has sinned and fallen away, we call that restoration. But with the exception of the actual commands obeyed for the child of God who's fallen away, it's repentance and prayer, which we'll get to in a minute, the end result is the same. He is restored to a relationship with God. So only the scope is different between the individual salvation or restoration and the global scale event, which we call the restoration movement. Let's notice the individual again. When a child of God sins, or a lost person, let's start there. When a lost person who originally was in fellowship with God sins, he falls away from fellowship. We teach him the gospel. He obeys that gospel. He then has fellowship with God again. We call it salvation, but it's really just restoration. The same process is happening in the restoration movement, which we study in our history books. It's just that we, so far removed from its happening, look at it as a large-scale event. We view it like the Renaissance, with a beginning and an ending. We view it like the Industrial Revolution, which has had its completion. Now, granted, the church has been restored. There is some finality to it, but not everybody is saved. Is that right? Not everybody has been restored back to or just to God. And so that idea of a restoration movement should be continuing. It should be alive, and it should be going, ongoing for us here today in the 21st century. We need to stop looking at the restoration movement as that which ended in 1900, and that which began in 1800. If you frame it in the context of salvation and reaching souls just in general, the restoration movement didn't begin in frontier America. It would have began on the day of Pentecost, after our Lord's resurrection, when Peter preached to a group of horror-struck Hebrews and told them, the harsh truth, that they were lost, that they had sinned. They were once with God, but they had sinned. And in so sinning, they murdered the Son of God, their Messiah. And then he told them the good news. Yes, you're lost, but you can be saved. That relationship you once had with God can be yours again. And they asked him the good question, how? What shall we do? And he told them, be restored. He didn't say that. What did he say? Repent and be baptized. And when you do, your sins will be taken away, remitted, washed away. And the relationship you lost, you'll have again. That's restoration. But later, as we'll get to later in the text, in the study, you have those Christians who fell away again on a global scale, who needed to again, as Peter told those Hebrews, obey God. And when they obey God, just like people today obey God, that New Testament Christianity can be restored once again. Let's notice two things in our time together this hour. I want us to first of all notice the fall and restoration of one. Because some of the very people that we try to reach with the gospel believe that they don't need to be reached. That they're saved, and once they're saved, they're always saved, or that they've been somehow pre-selected for salvation, and so everything I'm saying is just blowing smoke and is wasting their time. So we need to first convince people the reality of apostasy, that they can fall away, and in so falling away, they lose the fellowship that they originally had with God. And if they don't get right with God, when this eternal soul leaves its physical body, they will spend eternity without God forever and ever. So we first study the fall and restoration of one, and then we simply apply that to a larger scale, and we'll notice then the fallen restoration of many. Let's start with the one. Your Bible, your New Testament is overflowing with references to warnings, fears, rebukes, and encouragements that teach a child of God may so sin as to lose his salvation, that he may walk away from the grace which he has in Jesus Christ. In fact, 2/3 of your entire New Testament is written with just that in mind. Romans through Jude, the epistles, written to warn and encourage brethren. First of all, to say you can be faithful, that you must be faithful, and if you're not faithful, what could happen? For example, Paul wrote to the Galatian brethren, Galatians 1:6, I'm shocked that you were so soon removed from him that has called you into the grace of Christ to another gospel. It's happened just that fast that you've fallen away. He would say in Galatians 5:6, Christ has become of no effect to you. Christ is worthless to you. If you try to be justified by the law, that is, of Moses, you're fallen from grace, which you have in Christ. You have salvation in Christ, but if you try to be saved from some other way than the Jesus way, you lose the salvation, the grace you have in Christ. Now, the Calvinist would say, you can't fall away. The Calvinist would say, once you're saved, you're just always saved. But Paul says differently. Peter would warn his brethren. Listen to their language, 2 Peter 2:20 through 22. Listen to the graphic description of not just Peter, but of my Father in heaven as he looks at his fallen away child. 2 Peter 2:20, for if after they have escaped the pollutions of the world through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and are again entangled therein and overcome, the latter end is worse with them than the beginning. Why, Peter? Because it's better for them never to have known the way of righteousness than to have known it and turned from the holy commandment delivered to them. Why, Peter? Because what happens to them is like the old saying come true, the true proverb, King James says. That it's like the pig who was washed goes back to its wallowing in the mire. It's like the dog who had vomited up its sickness, then foolishly went back to digest it. That's the picture, the graphic word picture my Father in heaven has of his child, my brother in Christ, Jesus' spiritual brother has. When that child of God goes back and is entangled in the thorns and in the briar patch and overcome again in sin. It's like a washed pig. Forget the pig part. That's not the point. The point is the washed part. Washed, but goes back to the mud. It's like a dog that had thankfully vomited up that which was making it sick, that sin, but then foolishly went back to digest it again. Don't tell me it can't be done. Peter is saying it's being done. You're the ones who are doing it. Get right with God. Now that's one person. That's one individual who sins and falls away. Probably the most specific example of a Christian's sin falling away and needing restoration is Simon, the former, my Bible calls him a sorcerer. He's not Merlin, folks. Let's call him a con man. He was a magician who uses sleight of hand. Let's put it that way. He pulled a con on the Samaritan people to make them think that he had some great power of the gods, until he heard the message of one Philip the evangelist. And he, like the gathering of Samaritans in that region who heard the preaching of Philip, obeyed the gospel. In fact, Acts 8:13, your Bible specifically says that con man obeyed the gospel. Simon himself believed and was baptized. Now Jesus says that means he's saved. He that believes and is baptized shall be saved. Simon believed and was baptized, therefore what? He's a Christian. I emphasize that, which is so obvious, because you'll have people who will say, because of what happens later in the text, he wasn't really a Christian. You see, he just said he was a Christian. He was just pulling a fast one. He's the con man pulling another con on those people, on Philip, on the Samaritans, apparently on the Holy Spirit too. He just said he believed, but Luke didn't write. The Holy Spirit didn't inspire him to say, Simon said he believed. It says Simon believed and was baptized. This now child of God is confronted with the temptation soon after, when Peter and John, the apostles from Jerusalem, come down to Samaria and start laying hands on those new Christians to give them the miraculous abilities that was needed in the first century. And when Simon sees the laying on of the apostles' hands means the giving of the Holy Spirit, he offers them a bribe, which is, I think we can all agree, a sin. And he says, give me also this power, that on whomsoever I lay hands, the Holy Spirit may be given. Now this is your brother in Christ, brother Simon, offering a bribe. And Peter says, your money perish with you. You think the gift of God could be purchased with money? You have neither part nor lot in this matter. He says, I can look into your heart and I can see that it's not right with God. You need to, brother, repent and pray. You need to be restored. You've fallen away. You were saved. You were with God. You were lost. You obeyed the gospel. Now you're falling away again. You need to repent and pray. Because I can see your heart, the apostle says, and that you are in the gall of bitterness, that you are, Acts 8:23, the bonds of iniquity. He did not say, as false teachers will lie with serpent tongues and smiling faces, he was yet in the gall of bitterness, that he was still in the bonds of iniquity. He didn't say still. He said, you're in it now, but you weren't 5 minutes ago before you offered the bribe. You were in fellowship with God, a saved Christian. Now you've fallen away. Be restored. That's the template. That's the recipe for one individual being restored. What is it? Simplifying it? Obey God. That's it. Obey God. If I'm lost, I obey God by believing and being baptized, as Simon did. If I'm saved and I fall away, I obey God by repenting and praying. But the end result is what? Restoration. That's for the one. Now, let's notice the many. Your Bible teaches collective rebellion. If one Christian can sin and fall away from Christ, could not a congregation of Christians sin and fall away from Christ? That's the warning that Jesus himself personally delivers, Revelation 2 and 3. To paraphrase, if you brethren don't get right, if you brethren do not repent, I will blow out the light of the candlestick. That symbolizes the fellowship between God and man, God and his child. That if you do not repent, I will remove its candlestick from its place, the candle from its lampstand. If you do not get right, you will lose. As a congregation, he writes, the fellowship you have with Christ. If one congregation can sin and fall away, could not an entire world of congregations sin and fall away? The question is not hypothetical. It's not allegorical. It's historical. It happened as early as the second century. It started happening. But before we get there, Paul has some prophecy for us. 2 Thessalonians 2:3 and 4. Let no man deceive you, that the day, that is to say, when Christ returns, will not come except there come a falling away first, when the man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God, or that is worshipped, so that he as God sits in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Who is this man of sin? To what specifically is Paul referring? Nobody argues he's talking about something in his future. But is it also in our future, or is it in our past? That's where the argument for a lot of people comes. Paul would warn the Thessalonian brethren, to Timothy personally, 1 Timothy 4, 1 through 3. The Spirit speaks expressly that in the latter times, Paul's future, some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils, speaking lies and hypocrisies, and having their conscience seared with a hot iron. They'll so flippantly and obviously go against God. How can they do that? Their conscience is just seared. They don't care anymore. What will they do? They'll forbid to marry, others to marry, commanding to abstain from meats, which God has been blessed to be received with thanksgiving of them which believe and know the truth. Just like with the Thessalonian text, Paul's talking about something that is to come. But when specifically? Who specifically? Fast forward a few centuries, the Protestants, those who protested the Roman Catholic Church, say the man of sin is obviously the Pope. And all the commands that the Pope lays down, the bishops can't marry or the priests can't marry and you have to abstain from meats on certain days, all of that. Obviously, Paul is talking about the Roman Catholic Church and their various heresies. The Roman Catholic Church would counter, point the finger at them and say, no, you're the apostates. You're the one who've gone away from the truth. We're the ones in the right. Have you seen that commercial recently? We wrote the Bible they put out. We'll get to them in a second. No, both are wrong. They're both pointing fingers at the other saying, you're not doing it our way. You're not doing it our way. You're not doing God's way. Neither one of them are doing it God's way. The problem is both of them, but we'll get to them in a second. Let's have some context first. We need to understand just what the Church of Christ is. It is not a denomination. If the Lord's Church, the Church of Jesus Christ, were a denomination, then what right do I have as a part of that body to tell someone who's in a denomination that they're wrong? If we're on equal footing, if you're in a denomination and I'm in a denomination, then who am I to tell you you're wrong? Who are you to tell me I'm wrong? We should all just hold hands and sing Kumbaya. But there's something special about the Church of Jesus Christ that is different from any man-made church, any capital C church, because the Church of Jesus Christ is a spiritual institution. Ephesians 3, 9 through 11, it is one which began in the very mind of God Himself to make all men see. Ephesians 3, 9, what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world has been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ, that now, under principalities and powers in heavenly places, might be made known by the church, the multicolored, the full spectrum of, the manifold wisdom of God. When you see the Church of Jesus Christ as written of and existing in the first century, you see the plan of God, the full wisdom of God, which came about after thousands of years of God's planning and purposing in existence. You see in the church the very wisdom of God Himself, according to the eternal purpose, His mind, which He purposed in Christ Jesus our Lord. You see, because before God ever made you, before He ever made you, He knew you would sin against Him. He knew that I, His created being, would sin against Him. It happened the very first one He made, Adam and Eve, sinned against Him. And because He put in my physical, doomed to die one day, physical being, an eternal spirit with a starting point but no ending point, He knew that that eternal spirit, if it's not in fellowship with Him, when it leaves this physical body, it's got to go somewhere. And out of fellowship with God, it can't be in His presence. So He made a place for eternal beings to dwell outside of the presence of God. He made it first for the devil and his angels, Matthew 25, 41. Who were the first ones to sin against Him, if I understand my Bible correctly? Those eternal beings with a starting point but no ending point, Satan and his followers, sinned against God, walked away from the fellowship of God. Well, they can't stay in God's face. So He had to make a place where He was not. That's hell. And if I am not in fellowship with God, when I leave this world, my eternal soul's got to go somewhere too. And it will go there. That's what Jesus says. Depart from me, I never knew you, to the place prepared for the devil and his angels. But if I'm in fellowship with God, my eternal soul gets to be with God. Enter in to the joy set before you. John 14, the place prepared for me. Heaven itself. And throughout the Old Testament, God spoke of, He peppered his old writing with references to and prophecies of a spiritual institution wherein God would simply house saved people from the whole world of condemned people. That spiritual institution, which is referenced all throughout the Old Testament, we're going to notice three of those references very quickly. First, Isaiah 2. 2 and 3. It shall come to pass in the last days that the mountain of the Lord's house will be established in the top of the mountains, exalted above the hills, and all nations shall flow unto it. And many people will go and say, come ye, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob. He'll teach us His ways, we'll walk in His paths, or put simply, we'll have fellowship with God again. For out of Zion shall go forth the law and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. Daniel would interpret the prophecy of Nebuchadnezzar, Daniel chapter 2 of his letter. And he would envision, or he would see in that dream, or in the interpretation of it, a great statue with a golden head, with chest and arms of silver, with a torso and thighs of brass, with legs and feet of iron and iron and clay. And he would say, Nebuchadnezzar, though that temple, or rather that statue represents, those different elements represent different kingdoms of here and to come. But I see something more than just a statue. I see also a great mountain with a stone cut out of it, cut without hands. That is to say, it's of divine origin. And that stone would strike at the feet of that statue, toppling it, and from its ashes would arise a new kingdom, which shall never be destroyed. Why? Because those different elements, as I say, Nebuchadnezzar, represent different kingdoms, and guess what? You're the golden head. And don't you know that arrogant king loved to hear that? Probably tuned out for the whole rest of the sermon. Oh, I'm the golden head. Missed the rest of it, which is after you will come another kingdom, which will consume yours. And after them, another kingdom, which will consume them. And after them, another kingdom that'll consume them. Well, now, premillennialists, and I've got the teacher right here to shake his head or nod, say those different kingdoms represent kingdoms that we're still waiting on. Don't they say that? It's still to come. Some of those kingdoms we haven't seen yet, because they're waiting for a 1,000-year reign of Christ, which just can't happen the way they word it. But Daniel defeats that in that text. He immediately localizes it. You're the golden head, Babylon, and after you will come another. Well, why would Daniel mean in 10,000 years? Why wouldn't he mean soon after, when the Medo-Persian Empire would rise? And after them, the Macedonian Empire under Alexander? And after them, the Roman Empire with the Caesars? What's so special about the Lord's kingdom that it could crack and destroy and shatter that statue of all those world empires? Because unlike those empires, my king can never be destroyed, so his kingdom can never be destroyed. You see, Nebuchadnezzar, you're going to die. Xerxes, dead. He doesn't stand a chance. Alexander, killed him. What happened to Julius Caesar? He died so famously they made a play about it. The Caesars are going to die. But Jesus, you can't kill my king. Oh, you could put him in the grave, but up from the grave he arose 3 days later. You can't keep him down, and so his kingdom you can't destroy. It's a spiritual institution, not a physical one, like the Hebrews writer said. Not of this construction, not a temple in Jerusalem, not a cathedral in Salt Lake City. It's a spiritual one. And Daniel tells you when it's coming, in the days of the Roman Empire. Joel 2, we've got Isaiah 2, he tells you the what of the kingdom, it's the mountain of the Lord's house. Daniel 2 tells you the when of the kingdom, the days of the Roman Empire. And Joel 2 tells you the how of this kingdom. When it comes, miracles are coming with it. Joel 2, 28 through 32. And it shall come to pass afterward that I'll pour out my spirit upon all flesh. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your old men will dream dreams. Your young men will see visions. Upon servants and handmaids I'll pour out my spirit. There are some miracles coming, Joel says. And I'll show wonders in the heavens and in the earth. Blood, fire, pillars of smoke. Sun turned to darkness. Moon turned to blood before the great and, mine says terrible, notable, big, significant day of the Lord come. Any Hebrew reading that text especially, his mind immediately goes back to the Exodus. Blood, fire, pillars of smoke. Because they think of the sacrificed Passover lamb. Blood, fire, smoke, which led them out of Egypt and led them through the wilderness by night and by day. In other words, Joel is saying there's a new law coming. There's a new Exodus coming. You've got a new Moses coming. So get ready. And it's coming with miracles. It shall come to pass when that day comes that whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be delivered or saved. For in Mount Zion and in Jerusalem shall be deliverance, as the Lord has said, and the remnant whom the Lord shall call. So in Jerusalem, Isaiah, in the days of the Roman Empire, Daniel, will come an outpouring of the Holy Spirit, according to Joel. You don't need to look around. You don't need to wonder. Your Bible tells you exactly when that happens. Because Peter, when he stands up to preach, immediately says, we're not drunk, Acts 2. This is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. And then he quotes from the text we just read. So stop telling me, you false teachers, that time he's talking about is thousands of years away. No, it's thousands of years ago. It's already happened. And when it happened, what happened to people who first heard that first gospel sermon? As we already said, Peter concluded it by saying, you murdered the Messiah. And they, now realizing the severity of their spiritual situation, said, what are we going to do? Wouldn't you say that if you found out you were lost? If you had a heart that could be pricked with the gospel? And Peter said, repent and be baptized, and you can be saved. And then when people of that million or so did that, 3,000 of those million did that, they were added, Acts 2:47, to the little c, body of the saved. My Bible says, church. They were added to the church by the Lord as they were being saved, soul by soul, being restored back to God in the form of salvation in Jesus Christ. And from there, the church starts being established. That is, saved people start happening all over the world. Starts in Jerusalem, then Judea, then Samaria, then the othermost parts of the world, just like Jesus said it would happen. And congregations of Christians start assembling all over the world, but they're not assembling by following some physical headquarters in Atlanta or Salt Lake City or in Rome. They're autonomously organized, following simply, how novel is it, the simple New Testament being written to them, instructing them on how to live, how to worship, and how to follow God. And that's all they're following. That's the only law that they have, because that's the only law that they need. That's important when we get to the second century and beyond in just a second. But that's the church. It is a spiritual institution. It is really, don't nobody throw tomatoes when I say this, let me explain. It is a state of mind. It's a state of God's mind. You see, there's nothing physically about me that looks any different from anybody anywhere in the entire world. But Jesus looks at me. God looks at me differently. He looks at me as though I had never sinned. Now, I've sinned. How about you? I have in my past the reality of sin. I can never say I've not been a sinner. I can never not have been a sinner. Did I word that right? That's all in our past. Can't change it. God can't change it. What I need for God is to look at me as though I had never sinned. Because if he looks at me as a sinner, I can't see his face for all eternity. So I need him to look at me differently. And he looks at me justified, never sinned. The person who's not saved, he looks at him just like he is. He's a sinner. Can't help it unless you obey the gospel, God says. So he doesn't separate the world from me. The world's already condemned, and I'm a part of it, John 3:17. But when I'm saved, he separates me from the world, 1 Peter 2:9. That's the church. It's a spiritual institution, and it starts popping up all over the world thanks to the preaching and teaching of the missionary work of the early Christians and the apostles. And you have congregations being established that following the New Testament that is being written to them, which we, how convenient, have bound in leather, mine's bound in duct tape, have bound in our laps that we can read, those people had the letters being written just as authoritative, and they follow those letters to know how to live generally, how to worship specifically, and by following the qualifications given, they knew how to appoint certain ones to oversee their general work. We call them elders, which designates them as the so-called wise old men in the room. We call them sometimes bishops, which symbolizes their authority that they have. Or we call them a presbytery, which means they're a council that have to get together to resolve and discuss and make decisions as a group. We call them pastors or shepherds because they shepherd a flock of Christians. The point is, in the New Testament, which is when we know they were doing right, there was a plurality of them autonomously overseeing individual congregations. But as early as the second century, things start changing. Why? Because the apostles are dead, and all they've got is the word of the apostles. Well, it's easy to twist a word when the guy's not there to say, hey, that's not right. It's easy when the parents are away for the children to get in trouble, and as soon as, there's a get, I threw one in there. As early as the second century, I'm a former student, as early as the second century, with John dead, the last of the apostles, the parents are away, falling away starts. And it starts in the very makeup of what makes a congregation of Christians a congregation of faithful Christians in the organization of the church. Wherein originally there was a plurality of elders or bishops or whatever you want to call them, according to the New Testament, overseeing the congregation. They would appoint now one bishop over the eldership over the congregation. And that's just history. You won't find that in your Bible because your Bible was done at this point. But that's just history. As early as the second century, the heresy of the monarchical bishop started, with one bishop overseeing the elders. Why? Because it was convenient, because it was expedient. That doesn't make it right, but that's why they did it. And this one bishop, being evangelistically minded, good for you, decides he wants to establish a congregation 6 miles down the road, who now assemble somewhere in another town, who have elders overseeing them, but he stays the bishop over both. Well, what a sweet setup. And now two congregations are overseen by one man. You see how different it's become in just 100 years? And two becomes four. Four becomes eight. Eight becomes 16 until eventually in the 300s, we're not very far removed. In the 300s, there's a council of bishops called in Nicaea, and they officially recognize the bishops of the church of Antioch, Rome, and Alexandria. Alexandria, Antioch, and Rome. Just basically corner to corner over the known world as the heads of the church in their respective areas. I'm doing a lot of paraphrasing, but that's generally what happened. That's your history. And, you know, it doesn't stay three. It's got to end up with one. Because what happens when people of citizens of the Roman Empire, which the world basically was, start looking to Rome for their physical laws, made sense to start looking to Rome for their spiritual laws. And so they started looking just to the Roman bishop to get their advice, to get their spiritual guidance. Which is ironic, because in the second century, when this heresy first started, Rome was one of the last regions to adopt it. But now, not soon after, their bishop is being called by Christians all over the world Papa or Pope. And they call him the head over the church, universal. What's that word for universal in the Latin? Catholic? So now you have one bishop called Pope as the head of the Roman universal church, the Roman Catholic church. I have friends who are Catholic. I don't mean to anger. I don't mean to upset. But let's view the Roman Catholic church in its proper historical context. It is simply that which was formed after multiple small deviations from the New Testament standard, where there was once one congregation overseen by a plurality of men, has now become an entire world of congregations overseen by one man who starts forbidding to marry, command to abstain from meats, and all of those things, plus a lot more that Paul didn't mention. And so you have a gross departure from the New Testament standard, a world of Christianity that has completely fallen away from what is right, needing to be, what's our magic word? Restored. Except it doesn't start now with restoration. It starts first with a reformation. You have reform heroes. And let's call them heroes. These men risked life and limb. If you study John Wycliffe, literally risked limb. Life and limb to fight an institution more powerful than any world government you've ever seen. Excuse me. That was a hiccup. You have reform heroes like Wycliffe, Luther, Calvin, and others who see the corruption of the Roman Mother Church and say something's not right. No entity of God can be this wrong-headed. But instead of trying to just simply go back to the Bible, they just try to nip at the edges. They just try to smooth the rough edges, to tweak it here and there. Well, all you're doing is putting lipstick on a pig. All you're doing is putting a Band-Aid on an amputated arm. You need to reattach the arm first. You've got to go back to what God said is right. They weren't doing anything more than just smoothing the rough edges around that inherently flawed entity. You can't fix something that's wrong in and of itself. These reform heroes, let's give them their props, largely admirable in their work, but their efforts are failures because they could never envision a Christian world where the Pope didn't exist. But it did exist. It's called the first century. They just couldn't see that far back. The Roman Catholic Church was too big. History itself was still written by Roman Catholic historians. So you can see their dilemma. Doesn't excuse them, but you can understand it. Now, because of their results, we don't have a restored church. We have now a great plurality of other man-made churches in the form of offshoots or parts of the whole. That's the meaning of the word denomination. A dime is a denomination of a dollar. Well, the Baptist, Methodist, Anglican, Presbyterian, etc. are either offshoots of the Roman church or they're offshoots of the offshoots. Either way, nobody was going back to the Bible yet. And so now, because of their failed efforts, we have the world in which we live today, with a plethora of denominations. Back then it was hundreds, now it's close to thousands, if not thousands plus, who all claim to have fellowship with one another, yet they all teach different things, hold to different hierarchies, follow different creeds, yet they say that they all have fellowship with one another until you put them in a room and make them actually talk about the Bible, then they realize just how much they don't agree. Well, you do things your way, we do things our way, nobody's doing things God's way is the problem. Any unbiased individual can look at the state of denominational Christianity and say it doesn't pass the smell test. They wonder why they have trouble converting people. Because I can look at it and see you guys are a living contradiction. You would have to believe that God simply doesn't care how people worship Him for that to exist and be right. And that flies in the face of 66 books of your Bible. God does care. It would take hundreds of years, excuse me, before a new generation of Bible thinkers would emerge. Fueled not only by the continued corruption of the Roman Catholic Church, but by the now myriad of contradictory religions that have sprang from that Roman Catholic Church in the form of man-made denominations. These men, largely independent from one another, would advocate a new kind of religious revival, not a reformation of the inherently flawed entities, but a soul-by-soul restoration of the simple, pure, divine, spiritual body of Christ. And so you have men like James O'Kelly. Almost done. Don't get up. Almost done, though. You have men like James O'Kelly, an Episcopal-turned-Methodist from Virginia, who gathered with other fellow disillusioned denominationalists and said, you know, the Bible only is good enough. Let's just do that. The name Christian only is good enough. Let's just wear that. How novel an idea. Abner Jones, a Baptist preacher in the New England area, had a similar epiphany, though no at all in any way connected with O'Kelly. He said, why don't we just call ourselves Christians? Why don't we do away with this whole denominational thing? The Bible doesn't talk about it. Well, bravo, good sir. How come no one else was thinking about this for 2,000 years? The Bible doesn't talk about it. So what are we doing following it? Almost 1,000 miles south of that New England preacher was a Presbyterian preacher who had ties personally to the Anglican, Baptist, Methodist, and Episcopal faith. Spiritually, he's been around. Named Barton Stone. He was hosting a revival for the Presbyterian Church in Cane Ridge, Kentucky. A revival assisted by preachers from the Methodist and Baptist faith. So here is the experiment. The laboratory is Cane Ridge. The experiment is, can denominations get along and work together? And in that meeting, they did. It was a great success. Barton Stone got all excited, said, let's work together more. But you know what? It was dead on arrival. Because they started saying, you do things that way, and you do things that way, and we just can't. So Barton Stone threw his hands in the air and said, I've had it with denominations. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to start my own Springfield Presbytery. Which is exactly what happened after the efforts of Calvin and Luther. And so you think he's going to fall in the same trap, but thankfully he doesn't. I'm fixing to move fast forward, okay, because I'm not done yet. He doesn't do that. As soon as they formed that Springfield Presbytery, they moved to disband it because they realized how wrong-headed the approach was. But before they do so, they draft a literal last will and testament of that man-made religion where they talk about the little c churches of Christ, how they're supposed to be autonomous and overseen by elders, and how they want that body, that Springfield Presbytery, which is wrong in its existence, to simply be dissolved into the one body of Christ. It's like drafting the Declaration of Independence, but religiously. And just like the drafters of that Declaration of Independence, they came under attack by their enemies as soon as they put their names on the paper. Men who criticized them called them Stonites. They called them New Lights. You know, it's interesting. Nobody called them Campbellites. Why is that? Because 3 years later, Thomas Campbell landed in America, started preaching in Pennsylvania as part of the Presbyterian Church. And the more he preached his Bible, the more he preached only his Bible, and they called him a false teacher, which he kind of was, because all he did was preach his Bible. So he left the Presbyterian Church and started advocating not a non, but an undenominational Christianity. And all over the country, people started having this epiphany. Why was this so popular in frontier America? Because they just had a war of independence. And what is more independently minded than, I don't need to answer to Rome, I don't need to answer to Atlanta. I don't need to answer to Boston or Salt Lake City. I can just follow God as the Bible says, just between me and God. Listen, sidebar, please give me a second. You've got people today who say the gospel is no good anymore. It can't be reached. People are too unreligious. Balderdash. I look on my news and I see people going to town hall after town hall, frustrated with top-down government. Take that message and apply it spiritually. There's nothing more top-down government than the Baptist Church, the Methodist Church, the Roman Catholic Church. They're telling you how you have to worship God. I'll let God tell me how I need to worship God. Take that top-down government and apply it to churches, and you'll see we are on the cusp of a spiritual revival if we would just take the message out. Alexander Campbell said, let us return to the original church. He didn't want to start a new church. And so these so-called restorers started preaching this restored Christianity. As early as the 20th century, after that movement really took off, the little c churches of Christ became the fastest growing religious movement in North America. And now in the 20th century, you have men like Hardiman, Nichols, and Woods who carried on that message in the early 20th century to the greatest generation, as we call them, those morally minded, values oriented people. And that message again just took off. See what happens when you sow the seed? It'll eventually find fertile soil. Today, though, granted, America is a little different. We are outlawing religion piece by piece in my nation. We are becoming a mindset, at least among religious people, of I'm okay, you're okay, let's be different and stay okay. And so they don't even want to accept the possibility that they could be wrong. It's in our culture become taboo just to walk up to somebody and say, you might not be right. And so there's a lot of barriers, I grant you, that can get in the way of a restoration movement. But that doesn't mean the notion is antiquated. That certainly doesn't mean the notion is dead. The seed is still the word. We have congregations that throw up their hands and say, we can't reach people. Let's keep who we have. You're sitting on a big bag of seed. Go sow it. You'll find some people. People who are frustrated with the contradictions of man-made religion and who are hungering and searching. Who, to quote Campbell, want the old gospel back, sustained by the ancient order of things. It is to those people the members of Christ's church preach. To them is extended the invitation to follow the pattern given by God, to repent of the sins that keep one separated from God, and in full obedience to the commands of God, be restored. to a proper relationship with God. Stepping and removed from capital C churches, top-down government, man-made religions. And every time the gospel reaches a fertile-hearted soil, a fertile-soiled heart, let's put it that way, the New Testament church is restored. And that individual, and according to my Bible, New Testament Christianity is restored in that individual too. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Brother Matt.